inside the Borg, and free from the hive mind, this is Rex Bear, hosting Leap Project. The Leap Project was created to offer awareness and information not found in the mainstream news. With over 90% of the world's media controlled by only six enormous conglomerates, many people today are looking for more accurate information. The Leap Project offers a refreshing approach to the brain-drained media. Check back daily for new content as we thrive to bring you the cutting edge in news, current events, on-scene video footage, interviews, and most importantly, the truth.
Tonight's guest is Nick Redfern, a full-time author and journalist specializing in a wide range of unsolved mysteries, including Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster, UFO sightings, government conspiracies, alien abductions, and paranormal phenomena. He writes regularly for the London Daily Express newspaper, 14 times, Fate, and UFO magazine. His previous books include Three Men Seeking Monsters, Strange Secrets, Cosmic Crashes, and the FBI Files, among his many exploits. Redfern has also investigated reports of lake monsters in Scotland, vampires in Puerto Rico, werewolves in England, aliens in Mexico, and sea serpents in the United States. Nick, thanks so much for joining us tonight. How are you doing?
I'm doing good, thanks, Rex. How's it going?
Hey, fantastic. So tell our listeners, Nick, what got you into the realms of conspiracies and UFOs, and how long have you been doing it?
Well, I got interested, I suppose, to a degree at least, when I was a little kid and my parents took me on a week's holiday to Scotland and we spent a day at Loch Ness. And, you know, if you're going to go to Scotland, you've got to go to Loch Ness. And I was only about 5 or 6 years old at the time, but I've still got a few fragments of memories of my dad telling me the story of the Loch Ness Monster and how, you know, there was sort of this supposed colony of unknown animals or weird creatures in Loch Ness, and I can still vaguely remember standing on the shore the first time I went there, and, you know, just sort of, I guess at that age, you sort of view it along the lines of stories of monsters in the closet or under the bed or whatever. It's more like a, you know, like a, just a story. But as I got older, I began sort of reading books on weird phenomena. This would have been sort of, by the time I started reading books sort of seriously in the subject, this would have been late 1970s, 1980, when I would have been about sort of 14, 15. And I started reading like John Keel and Brad Steiger and things like that. And primarily had an interest and still have an interest in mainly two issues, one being the UFO subject and the other one being cryptozoology, the study of unknown animals. And so that's what kind of got me interested in the subject. But in terms of writing, what happened was that when I left school, I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I wasn't exactly what you would call the best or most successful student. I was, you know, sort of a typical late starter. And, you know, I just didn't do good at school. And I sort of walked out, literally walked out, which is another story. And, you know, just, what are you going to do? And it just, as fate would have it, I got offered a job, like an 18-month job, working on a magazine in the town I was living at the time. It was called Zero, and it was like a music and entertainment and fashion magazine for teenagers. And I was like 17 at the time then. And they sort of taught me all different aspects of journalism and you know, how to write articles and reviews and interviewing techniques, that sort of thing. And you know, I thought it was great because I didn't have to do a real job. I didn't have to wear a shirt and tie and a suit, you know, and I was getting paid to go to write reviews, which was brilliant. You know, it was kind of like being paid for just something you enjoy doing rather than a job. And I kind of found that I enjoyed doing writing. And I did that for about 18 months, and then that job dried up, and then I just had a bunch of other jobs for about the next 5 or 6 years, everything from van driver, forklift driver, sold insurance, or tried to, just a range of different things. And then when I got to about 25, 26, I thought, well, why not try and get back into writing and pursue it full time? And I basically just took a chance and I quit the job I was in and thought, well, I'm going to put it, you know, I got a bit of money in the bank, I got a roof over my head, and I was like, well, I'm going to give it a go. If it doesn't work after 12 months, okay, I'll go back to the real world. Unfortunately, it did, and I, you know, got a couple of book deals, and it sort of went from there. So that's sort of the answer to the question. It goes back to, you know, as a kid at Loch Ness and then sort of having a background in writing and then expanding on that.
You know, and speaking of Loch Ness, there's a lot of fascination around that area of the world and obviously Nessie or the Loch Ness Monster. Did you ever actually see the Loch Ness Monster?
No, I didn't. I mean, a lot of people don't realize sort of the sheer size of Loch Ness. I mean, it's like 22 miles long, about a mile wide, and anywhere from about 600 to 700 feet deep. And there are possibilities that in some of the lower cavernous areas where the caves, nobody really knows how deep they go, it could extend to sort of like 900, 1,000 feet, possibly even more. So when you've got a huge body of water like that, and the water's almost, you know, it's very, very black and dark, you've really got to be in the right place at the right time to see something. Now, on top of that, there actually aren't that many sightings a year. You know, we do get good sightings a year, but it's probably only six or seven. Now, that kind of suggests that for the most part, these creatures, whatever they are, live almost exclusively underwater. You know, in other words, they're not mammals like us. If they were something like a whale, you know, they'd have to be surfacing all the time to take oxygen in. And if there were a colony of 20 or 30 of them, we'd be getting hundreds of reports every year, every time they break the surface, you know, to take in oxygen. But right. The fact is they don't. So that seems to suggest there's some sort of, like a fish or a fish-like animal that has gills and gets its oxygen under the water and hardly ever needs to surface unless it just feels like surfacing, you know. So I think that's why we don't get many sightings, because the creatures really don't need to come out of the water, you know, like a mammal. So, you know, when you put that together as well with the size of the loch, you know, it's not surprising that...
There's also a lot of mysticism and folklore that goes with Loch Ness, the Loch Ness Monster. I'd like to get into maybe what research you have possibly with, so not only Aleister Crowley, but Robert Plant. They were fascinated with the Loch Ness Monster. They bought a castle actually off of Loch Ness, didn't they?
Well, kind of. Yeah, I'll explain the full story. But well, as I said, one of the big interests I have is cryptozoology, which is the study of unknown animals like Bigfoot and the Loch Ness Monster. And most cryptozoologists take the view that these things we look for are just regular flesh and blood animals, but of a type that science and zoology hasn't classified or recognized yet. But I look into it from a kind of a different perspective, and so do a number of my colleagues, but, you know, we're certainly in the minority. But there's no doubt that when you look into the phenomena of these weird animals, you find a lot of strange connections to them that suggest that they're not just unknown animals that science hasn't found. They seem to have paranormal overtones to them. And a classic example is Loch Ness. Now, it's actually not a castle. It's an old house on the shores of Loch Ness called Burleskin House, which Aleister Crowley, the famous occultist, purchased and lived in from the early part of the 20th century. And he supposedly tried to conjure up demons from within Loch Ness. And Loch Ness had a tradition of creatures that were known as water horses or Kelpies, that's a Scottish term, going back centuries. And Kelpies were sort of supernatural shape-shifting creatures that would drag people to their deaths in the depths of the water of the loch. So in other words, long before the Loch Ness Monster by that name existed, there were these stories of these so-called water horses in Loch Ness. But after Aleister Crowley supposedly engaged in all these rites and rituals to conjure up demons, it kind of ushered in the more modern era of the Loch Ness Monster, like in the 1930s onwards. And this has sort of given rise to the idea that the Loch Ness Monster, or monsters, are somehow supernaturally based and can be invoked and conjured up, if you like, in the way that Crowley did. Now, in the 1970s, Burleskin House was bought actually by Jimmy Page, who was Led Zeppelin's guitarist. And he lived in the house for a number of years. And he also said that the place had this sort of weird, oppressive atmosphere to it, you know, kind of like just a spooky old haunted place. And Loch Ness is a weird place. You know, you can even take the Loch Ness Monster out of the equation. And we have a lot of UFO reports from Loch Ness. Men in Black encounters. There was a famous Man in Black encounter on the shores of Loch Ness in 1973. There have been sightings of other unusual animals, like large black cats, like the size of mountain lions in the US, roaming around the shores of Loch Ness, and there should not be anything of that type running wild in the UK, never mind of all places at Loch Ness. There have been ghostly sightings of like a spectral airman who reportedly was killed when an aircraft crashed in Loch Ness during the Second World War. In other words, Loch Ness, for a place that is just sort of perceived as somewhere where these strange animals live, when you begin to dig into it and get under the surface, you find that the loch is sort of saturated by paranormal phenomena, of which the Loch Ness Monster is actually just a small part of it. There's a lot of strange stuff. Now, a lot of cryptozoologists, you know, they don't like dealing with all this paranormal stuff. They just kind of want to focus on, oh, it's just, you know, it's either a surviving creature from the dinosaur period or it's an animal that we haven't classified yet. They don't like, I don't know why, but they kind of just steer away from even addressing this issue that there could be something paranormal. But for me, you know, when you've got witness reports who said they've seen huge black cats on the shore, or they've had UFO encounters, you know, strange lights over the loch, or you have the story like Aleister Crowley, it's kind of stupid to ignore the evidence. You know, it's almost like, for some people, it becomes a belief system that it's got to be this and they don't want to know about anything else. And for me, that's the wrong approach. You know, the most important people in the subject, I always tell people, are the witnesses, because without the witnesses, we got nothing to go on. So when they say, you know, I was up at Loch Ness, I didn't see the monster, but I saw a UFO or I saw a huge black cat, something weirder going on. But if there's something weirder going on, well, that's just how it goes. You know, why try and force the evidence to just fit one scenario when it clearly suggests it doesn't fit?
Right. Right, and you said there was a Men in Black encounter in 1973.
Yeah, this actually involves a guy named Ted Holliday, who was a Loch Ness Monster researcher from the 1960s onwards. And like most people who investigated the Loch Ness Monster, including me, he started off believing that it was, you know, a colony of just unknown creatures living in the loch. But he began to experience a lot of weirdness when he was at Loch Ness. He used to take... he had a full-time job and used to take like the same several weeks every summer so he could go up to the loch and hang out, you know, and just have his camera ready day and night. And he would have weird experiences. He'd have strange synchronicities, sort of like, which are like meaningful coincidences. And he would experience things when he would try and photograph certain areas of the loch, or when he thought he'd seen something on the loch that was strange, that his camera would jam or the pictures would come out fogged. But it wouldn't happen at any other time. And he spoke to colleagues and other witnesses who'd also had strange experiences like that. And he came to believe that the Loch Ness Monster was paranormal-based rather than flesh and blood. And he was on the shores of the loch in one particular area in the summer of 73, when he had this kind of feeling that we all get it sometimes, that you think somebody's looking at you and you turn around and they are. You know, you kind of have that sense when you're sort of in the checkout line at the local store or whatever. And as he turned around, there was this sort of literal classic Man in Black, you know, as they're known within the UFO subject, standing there. And he got this, Ted Holliday got this weird sense of like malevolence and evil emanating from this character. And there was suddenly this, like a swish of wind, and he literally vanished. Now, literally 12 months to the day, because Ted Holliday took his vacation at the same time every year, 12 months to the day, he was back in the same part of the loch, taking photographs, when he was suddenly knocked to the ground with a near-fatal heart attack. And he realized that when the ambulance guys, who'd been called by somebody else was on the scene, when they stretched him away, they actually took him across the stretch of ground where the Man in Black had been seen exactly 1 year previous to the day. And that was something else that sort of reinforced for him the idea that, you know, there was something paranormal going on. And unfortunately, he didn't really recover from the heart attack, and he died earlier in 1979 when he wasn't even 60.
Did he explain what the Men in Black guy looked like?
Well, actually, he said he was dressed totally in black, and the weird thing was he had like a black motorcycle helmet on, but the visor was black. Everything was black. Black gloves, like black leather outfit. But it was just, that was even the weirder thing, to see this guy like on the shore of the loch, you know, in just black gear. But what was even weirder was, as I said, when there was this swish of wind and he just vanished. I mean, literally vanished. Again, which, you know, we have no real explanation for that if we accept it literally. And according to Ted Holliday, that was literally how it happened.
So, and you've probably done extensive research on different cases of Men in Black, correct?
On the Men in Black, and I've actually got a third one coming out this year, because there are so many reports. And it's kind of like with the Loch Ness Monster, where people first assume, you know, it's just an unknown animal and there's nothing else to it. It's kind of like that with the Men in Black, where people think, oh, they're government agents. You know, they're silencing people in the UFO subject, kind of like in the movies with, the Will Smith and Tommy Lee Jones films. And that's all they are, you know, the secret employees of a even more secret agency. But the reality is that that imagery of the Men in Black is very much sort of created by the movies. But if you go back to the UFO books from the 50s onwards, when the Men in Black mystery really began, and this is right through to the present day, most of the people who have reported MIB encounters, and certainly a good, 95, 96, 97% of all the ones I get are very different. They describe the Men in Black as really nothing like Will Smith or Tommy Lee Jones. They're more like pale-faced vampires, sort of very skinny, emaciated, white skin, sort of sunken cheeks. They come across like more like less like the X-Files and more like something straight out of an H.P. Lovecraft novel. And the Men in Black are often, they're linked with the UFO subject. But I've got a lot of reports where people have been visited by the Men in Black after they've been dabbling with Ouija boards or things like alchemy. And even with poltergeist activity, and then they've had a knock on the door from the Men in Black, warn them not to dabble in the occult. With the Loch Ness Monster, what sounds like a government agency silencing UFO witnesses actually becomes something more or something less, depending on your perspective, where, the Men in Black have these sort of weird supernatural overtones to them as well.
You know, and it seems as if, Nick, a lot of people talk that when there is a UFO, when people have experiences with UFOs, they also tend to have more opportunities, I guess you could say, with the paranormal.
Yeah.
Have you noticed that to be a very strong connection, that usually the case is if there's a lot of exposure to AKA extraterrestrials or unidentified flying craft, there's also exposure to paranormal stuff?
Oh yeah, and again, this is something that doesn't go down with a lot of the people in the sort of mainstream UFO research field either. I guess when you're kind of in your teens or whatever, you kind of take a more simplistic approach to it. But again, like with cryptozoology, you know, as I got into my 20s and 30s, I came to realize that many of these phenomena were sort of interlinked, and my view is sort of more in line with John Keel, who wrote the Mothman Prophecies book and many other good books, that all these phenomena somehow are interlinked. And today I'm kind of less inclined to think that the UFO phenomenon is extraterrestrial, probably more interdimensional or multidimensional, and kind of coexists with us in a different reality, but zips in and out of our reality. And I think that goes for a lot of these crypto creatures. And it may explain why all these phenomena, they're all so elusive. You know, it's like they're here one minute and gone the next. And I think that could be because that literally is the case. You know, they're sort of zipping in and out of our reality. And I think that, as I mentioned, with Men in Black reports, I've got sightings or encounters with Men in Black linked with Ouija boards, with paranormal activity, with poltergeist events and things like that. And, if we're just talking about nuts and bolts aliens and so on. I don't think we should have these supernatural or occult overtones tied to them as well, unless there's something more going on. And I think that's sort of the approach I've taken for the last sort of 20 years or so, namely that, yes, these phenomena are all real, but they are far more or far less or far different to what we think they are. There's a bigger picture going on somewhere that, you know, ties these phenomena somehow at least all together. And, you know, when you get hundreds, as I've got, rip encounters, from very often from people who don't want their stories told. They just want someone who can hopefully provide them some answers to their questions, you know. And they've said there was like this knock on the door at 11 o'clock at night, and I opened the door and there was this sort of creepy little 5 foot tall guy with pale skin, dressed in an old type 50s suit and a fedora hat, and the person felt hypnotized and they allowed this guy to come in and essentially threaten them and interrogate them, and then they just got up and left, you know. And then the person's mind comes out of this sort of semi-trance-like state, you know. And I mean, I've literally got dozens and dozens of reports like that. As I said, they're nothing like the movies. They literally are kind of like the closest thing to a real-life vampire you could imagine, just sort of menacing, pale, skinny, dressed in black, and just emanating this or oozing this sort of sense of evil almost.
That sounds like the observers from the TV series Fringe that was on Fox for several years. They were pale.
They are not unlike that. And a lot of people don't know that the men in black in Fringe are based, in some cases at least, on existing reports of the men in black from the early days. And I think the best example, actually, if people want to get an impression of how most witnesses report the real men in black, have you ever seen the movie Dark City? Or if you haven't...
That's a good movie.
Yeah. Well, the men in black in that, they sort of just come out at night and they look, you know, they look like your worst nightmare. That's how most people actually report the men in black. If the people listening to the show have seen it, they'll know what I'm talking about. If they haven't, I recommend they watch it, because that really kind of nails the way the MIB look.
So if you feel that these flying saucers and these aka ETs, or most of them that people are seeing, are more interdimensional, that reminds me of that infamous phone call that was made on Coast to Coast several years ago, where a guy claimed to work with Area 51, and he sounded very frightened. He said, "You don't know what they really are. They're interdimensionals." And then a couple seconds later, supposedly Coast to Coast, all the electricity just went completely down. Do you remember that?
No, I actually don't, to be honest. No.
Okay, yeah, no worries. Yeah, it was you could YouTube it. It was this very, very interesting, because the guy seemed sincere. You know, could it have been a hoax to bring up ratings? Absolutely. But supposedly the entire studio went down on Coast to Coast, and, you know, they're a pretty big organization. So that could very well be something. But does that mean that, you know, these little gray men that people are seeing are actually from the other side, and there are no extraterrestrials?
No, I don't think we can rule one out against the other. And again, I think this is one of the problems as to why there's so much conflict in the research communities, because, you know, one person is, you know, one person is the cattle mutilation researcher. Somebody does abductions. Somebody thinks abductions, you know, are positive. Somebody else thinks they're negative. Somebody else focuses on alien implants. You know, it's kind of like everybody has their own theory, and they rigidly hold to that theory. Now, for me, I take the approach, well, we're not sure what's going on. We know there's a genuine UFO phenomenon that's, you know, nothing to do with the military or the government or whoever. It's genuinely unknown. But I feel that until we've got all the answers, we should remain open-minded in terms of the investigations. And I think that even if some UFOs are interdimensional or multidimensional, whatever you call it, that doesn't exclude not just the possibility, but the probability that there is life on other worlds. It's in the same way that, yes, some, you know, there are weird reports of, like, the Loch Ness Monster that seem to have paranormal overtones. But I actually think that some reports of strange creatures, particularly things like sea serpents in the oceans, they could just be regular unknown animals that science hasn't found. So, in other words, I don't sort of, just because I hold to one theory for one phenomena, doesn't necessarily mean that every aspect of the phenomena has to fall under the same thing. You know, there could be interdimensional visits, there could be extraterrestrial visits, and maybe they're somehow tied together. You know, maybe the sheer distances between us and the nearest star system means that they don't travel from point A to point B, that they sort of leap or jump dimensions, you know, to cope with the vast distances that prevent us from traveling to the nearest stars. You know, you kind of jump a dimension or a gateway, you know, to shorten the distance, so to speak. So in other words, it doesn't rule out one or the other.
Or maybe the Greys could be some type of like avatar that has been brought over here and there, as you say, from some different dimension where they have to. All these speculative questions,
yeah,
sure.
I mean, there's things with the Greys are interesting. I mean, some people take the view that they're sort of running the show. Other people think they're almost like a worker ant, that kind of situation. Or even, interestingly enough, something like a programmed biological robot where they're just performing a task. And maybe we've never really seen the intelligences that are behind the phenomenon. You know, we often assume that because people have interactions with the so-called Greys, for the most part, that they're the ones who are in charge. But what if they are just, you know, the equivalent of like drones sent out to perform a task, and the makers or the creators, you know, we've just never seen them. I think that's a possibility.
Right. And you've had access and extensive research in a plethora of declassified documents on flying saucers and alien phenomenon, correct?
Yeah, I've spent a lot. I use the Freedom of Information Act. There are a lot of countries around the world that have Freedom of Information Acts, and they allow the general public and the media to request files to be declassified. In some, depending on the regulations in the relevant countries, sometimes it could be after a certain number of years, or you just have to literally apply for the files to be declassified if they just remain almost indefinitely classified. And why I do this is because I think, particularly from the perspective when you're dealing with like skeptics and debunkers, if you can show them and demonstrate that there are government files showing where military pilots or airline pilots or radar operators have had UFO encounters, whether chasing them in the skies or tracking them on radar, can see that the case was subject to a degree of secrecy and the files have been, you know, under wraps for decades and only now surfacing. That adds a lot of weight to the argument that these phenomena are real. You know, when you've got official documents from agencies and personnel who are trained to know what goes on in our skies, and they're the ones who are saying, yes, we've seen UFOs. I think documents are an important part of the process of being able to show people that, yes, this is going on. So that's why I put a lot of emphasis on official files.
And different countries, from what I've seen, especially like Brazil, South America, they tend to be a lot more open with the public as well on the mainstream media outlets with flying saucers and ETs. Have you noticed particular countries that do give out the most information and have the most exposure?
Yeah, I think that's actually a good point. What I found is that the countries that I think aren't in the loop of the really deep secrets, that, you know, are out of the loop, they're the ones who are most likely to release their files because they don't, no one's telling them not to, or nobody's, you know, saying to them, yeah, we're all part of this big group and, you know, let's not reveal it. It's sort of the smaller independent nations that, you know, they're not storing crashed UFOs or alien bodies. They've just got a few hundred weird reports. So they're like, yeah, let's put it out there for people to see. But I think the nations that are sitting on the really deep secrets, they're the ones that are taking the stance of, well, yes, we'll release some things and see what the response is, but, you know, until the day comes when we have no choice, we're not going to reveal, you know, the sort of the trump card, so to speak.
Right. You know, it certainly seems, though, right now, the media outlets here in America are pushing for some type of disclosure, yet it seems also that there's been this carrot at the end of the stick now for decades. So the Vatican, they come out with somebody that they want to appoint. They want to baptize an alien. The United Nations appoints somebody ambassador. So do you feel that they're putting something together for that agenda where they're going to do this disclosure or fake disclosure? What have you found on that?
Well, I mean, Cartin's like several minds about all this, really. I mean, there's no doubt that, you know, the disclosure movements, for me, I think it's a very positive one in the sense of pushing for disclosure. You know, sort of taking the stance of like politicizing the subject where you are actually approaching senators and Congress, people in Congress, and, you know, putting together documentation packages and explaining why this material should be put out there and demonstrating that there is a cover-up. I think that's all valuable and should be done. But the cynic in me makes me think that, well, whoever it is that is hiding this data, you know, it doesn't matter how loud people shout, they're not going to reveal it until they're ready to do so. But what I do think has happened is that we've had a little bit of like a drip feed, certainly over the last decade or so. And, you know, I don't think it's a coincidence that people like the Vatican have come forward and made quite open statements that sort of 30 years ago would have been considered to be highly controversial on the idea of life outside of our planet. And, you know, you have to, I think, give some credence to the idea that this is being done to get the average, you know, member of the public thinking about the UFO phenomenon, thinking about what it might mean, thinking about the implications. And I think somebody somewhere is sort of monitoring the response and, okay, they've responded, you know, the public have responded positively to this, or they don't really care. And I think maybe the day will come, possibly, when the answers do surface, and by that time we'll be so acclimatized to it, it won't matter. But on the other hand, you know, if there are sort of deep and dark aspects to the phenomenon, who's to say that somebody hasn't decided there's no way we can ever tell them, you know? Or maybe it's a bit of both. You know, I think often people in the UFO field take the view that the UFO researchers are the good guys and the government are the bad guys. I actually think that approach, you know, at the end of the day, we're all human. And if we, as much as I want the truth to come out, you know, if somebody said to me, you know, hey, Nick, we're going to take you somewhere and tell you all the secrets. You know, you've been writing books about the subject, you know, be at this particular place at midnight and we're going to drive you there. Who's to say I wouldn't say when I was exposed to the evidence, wow, yeah, there's no way people can be told that, you know, if there's some huge dark secret that we don't know about. So I think, you know, it's not as cut and dry that the government are the bad guys and we're the good guys. We're all human, and I think for everybody, it's a difficult issue to deal with and to handle, and I think that goes for people in government as well. And the one other area where I differ in terms of the so-called government involvement in the UFO subject is that, you know, many people point the fingers at the Air Force or the CIA or the government as a body as being the bad guys when it comes to the UFO phenomenon and what's been hidden. I actually don't think, you know, that the government as a catch-all term or the Air Force are the people hiding the dark and deep secrets. What I think is there's almost like a shadow agency or a shadow government possibly that, you know, isn't answerable to anyone, isn't subjected to congressional oversight, that is probably funded via black budget means. So in other words, when the Air Force say, you know, we've got nothing on Roswell, we've gone searching for the files, we can't find anything, I truly don't think they're lying. I don't think they're the bad guys. I think Day's Air Force and CIA knows very little more than we do, you know, and they're but somebody knows, you see what I mean? And the problem is trying to find who that somebody is. You know, I think one of the reasons why the secret's being kept so well is because the people we expect or assume have the answers actually don't. I think it was all kind of siphoned off decades ago to some sort of shadow group, and they're the ones pulling the strings as to who knows and who doesn't. And the who doesn't may well even include presidents.
Well, you know, let's get into, if we can, some of these documents that you've had access to, maybe some of the recent stuff, or just a combination of everything. Where do you feel the secret agency is? Are they like an international body? Have you gotten any documents on that?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's certainly no doubt. If you look historically back at the late 1940s, sort of 47 onwards, when this whole thing began, you know, people like the Air Force, the FBI, the CIA were legitimately all carrying out investigations and little side projects here and there to figure out what was going on. But we actually do have some really good reports in the public domain through the Freedom of Information Acts of various countries of, you know, really credible pilot reports, radar reports, etc., from the late 40s and through the 50s. We have less reports of this high caliber from sort of the 60s, 70s onwards. You know, certainly there are some, like Rendlesham and things like that, but Lee, there's nowhere near on the scale of the 40s and 50s. Now, some researchers say, well, maybe they've just sort of cut back on their actions or they've gone home, you know. But I actually think it's a different thing. I think the reason why we saw so many reports in the 40s and 50s was because the regular agencies that we know about, the CIA, the Air Force, they were doing the investigations. I think why we have so few reports after that time is because, largely at least, other than acting in like a supporting capacity, these agencies really don't play a major role in the subject anymore. And I think it's sort of that 60s, 70s period when we saw probably like a siphoning off towards like a shadow agency to handle all this. One that probably not only wouldn't be, you know, subjected to congressional oversight, but because it officially doesn't exist, wouldn't also be subjected to freedom of information regulations, because not only does the agency not exist, we can't identify it, so we can't apply to them to get files, and nobody knows about them. So that's one of the problems as well. So I would sort of suggest maybe mid to late 50s onwards, somebody decided that this is such an important issue that it has to be handled by a group that is so different to any other agency that's ever existed, because it has to deal with a unique problem. And I think that's why we haven't sort of, you know, cracked the mystery, because everybody's knocking on the door of the Air Force and saying, you're the guys, you're hiding the Roswell bodies. I actually think, you know, there could be people sitting in the Pentagon now listening to this conversation, you know, on their radio in their supper break or whatever, saying, yeah, I wonder what did happen at Roswell, because even they don't know. You know, it's held so tightly, and people often have difficulty getting their mind around the concept that maybe the government, as we understand the term, actually doesn't know. But the trick is to figure out who does know, and that's, we're still facing, I think, that brick wall that we don't know any more than the government does, but someone knows, and it's, I think it's like this shadow type group.
And what documents have you had the opportunity to research on little gray men?
Well, that's an interesting issue, because for the most part, you know, we get a lot of UFO sightings, and these are reflected in the government files. But in terms of actual sort of, you know, the little gray man sighting type reports, there are very, very few official documents that refer to things like alien abduction events. Now, in saying that, there are a lot of stories and rumors about alien abductees being secretly watched and monitored and subjected to phone tapping and mail interference, may well be this particular agency. I'll give you an example. A good friend of mine and a sort of fellow writer, Greg Bishop. Greg in the 1990s had a lot of correspondence, early to mid-1990s, with a woman named Dr. Carla Turner, who's unfortunately now deceased, but she wrote a couple of very good books on her abduction experiences. And this was sort of pre, you know, major internet era. We're talking sort of 93, 94. And every time Greg and Carla would send letters to each other, they would arrive opened and resealed. And it was done in such a way, like the envelope was torn open and taped back up. It was done in such a way as to clearly let them know that the mail was being monitored. And it would only happen, you know, between Greg and Carla. You know, it wouldn't happen when Greg was getting his electric bill or a letter from his mom and dad or whatever, you know, just between him and Carla. So there are a lot of stories about abductees being secretly monitored by some sort of agency or body. But the problem is, this isn't reflected in the official files that have surfaced, and that's why, again, I think the main agencies are out of the loop, because they're clearly, you know, we're not seeing evidence of the FBI or whatever having a huge abduction file or something like that. But if these stories about sort of black helicopters flying over the homes of abductees are true, and there's certainly enough reports to suggest they are true, then clearly, you know, again, we need to look outside, I think, of the regular agencies and more towards an alternative type group sitting on top of all this.
Black helicopters, are they typically silent as well?
Well, sometimes they are, not always, but a lot of the reports, and certainly in the 70s and 80s, many people who had abduction experiences, and also in the cattle mutilation phenomenon as well, they were seeing black helicopters, and in many of those cases, in those two different areas, they were silent or almost totally silent, where people wouldn't hear the helicopter till it was literally like 30 feet away from them, and they'd suddenly hear this beating of, you know, a classic helicopter noise, and they'd turn around, and there's this black helicopter 30 or 40 feet behind them, just as if it had just snuck up out of nowhere, which, you know, a regular helicopter cannot do, you know. So, again, I think that because the average helicopter isn't silent, then if there are silent helicopters, clearly they fall under the ownership of somebody who's got them or developed them for these surveillance programs and nothing else. You know, they're not taking part in sort of, you know, when there are emergencies, forest fires or anything like that. It always seems to be in relation to the UFO phenomenon. So again, I think they're probably fall under the control of whoever's, you know, doing everything else in that particular subject as well.
And do you think a lot of the documents, too, that you've had access to or that anybody can get with Freedom of Information Act, if they just spend the time and know where to go, which is very difficult in certain circumstances, do you think that a lot of that also could be misinformation and disinformation?
Well, actually, I don't. I'll tell you for why, because many of the documents that have surfaced from the US and the UK from the late 40s and 50s are actually detailed chases by military aircraft of UFOs, where the UFOs were also tracked at the same time and independently on ground radar and airborne radar. And I think that, you know, if somebody wanted to misinform us or to downplay the UFO subject, you know, they wouldn't be declassing files showing that the military was chasing UFOs in the late 40s and 50s. You know, they would be saying the exact opposite, that all these sightings were just of stars or meteorites or whatever. What I think is more likely is that the files that have surfaced, as good as they are just, you know, a small fraction of what is actually on file. And again, I come back to, you know, if you go the FBI's website, for example, The Vault, which is a really good website, the FBI's official site where they've uploaded all of their UFO files, which is thousands of pages, and hundreds of pages on cattle mutilations, and you can download them all as PDFs, and they're filled with really good reports. I mean, even the cattle mutilation reports talk about black helicopter sightings and weird tripod landing marks and elevated radiation readings in the vicinity of the cattle mute. So in other words, you know, they're not holding back on this material. But again, I think that's because it's clear from the FBI's files that they were baffled by the cattle mutilation mystery, suggesting that the FBI was out of the loop. You know, again, I don't think the FBI is in on the loop as to who is doing the cattle mutilations. I think that's why they've released their files, because they don't know. But somebody, again, like with the UFO subject, somebody knows, somebody is overseeing a cattle mutilation monitoring program, but they're so deeply buried that even the FBI couldn't figure out who they were.
Yeah, I was actually thinking about that document that was released that was on the vaults web, the government FBI.gov/vaults website on Roswell, where they claimed to have found three craft with three beings in each craft that was about 3 foot tall. They didn't say that they were little green men, but yeah, clearly they said that they found something. So you also put a book together back, I think, in December 2011 when it was published, called Keep Out, Top Secret Places Governments Don't Want You to Know About.
Yeah, that was sort of a study of installations all around the world in various countries, or numerous countries. You know, everybody, you think of secret bases, everybody inevitably thinks of Area 51. You know, it is the world's most well-known secret base. It's like the ultimate oxymoron, right, as they say. It's well-known. Everybody knows about it, but it's top secret.
Right.
And a lot of people, I've been speaking to people, I realized that they thought Area 51 was pretty much the beginning and the end of everything. And then I realized that how many people actually, you know, just thought it did begin and end with Area 51, which is why I wrote the book, to demonstrate that there are numerous, you know, similar places to Area 51 all around the world where allegedly bodies and crashed UFOs have been stored and studied and back engineered allegedly and so forth. For example, back in England where I'm from, in the south of England, there's a place called Porton Down. And Porton Down is in the county of Wiltshire, which is sort of like rolling fields and hills and castles. You know, it hasn't changed for hundreds of years. But Porton Down is very much like an off-limits facility. And for many years, there have been rumors of alien bodies having been stored and studied at Porton Down, because it's where the British government does all its research into things like biological warfare and lethal viruses. And one of the theories is that the biology of the alien bodies has been studied to try and determine, you know, if they carry any viruses that could be weaponized, you know, as a weapon against enemy nations. So in that sense, you know, Porton Down is probably kind of like the closest, reportedly at least, kind of equivalent to Area 51. Now, the Russians reportedly in the Ural Mountains have a couple of highly fortified bases, literally buried inside the mountains, kind of like the equivalent of NORAD at Cheyenne Mountain over here, where again there are reports of people seeing like weird-looking alien bodies in cryogenic storage, reportedly being autopsied and studied. The Chinese supposedly have one. I've been on a number of investigations to Puerto Rico looking for the so-called Chupacabra, and every time I've been there, I've heard stories about underground installations in the El Yunque rainforest where UFOs have been seen coming out, and also coming out of the oceans, which has given rise to the idea of like an undersea base. So that's basically the theme of the book, Keep Out. It was sort of like a worldwide study of, you know, Area 51s and the Russian Area 52 or whatever, you know, that kind of thing.
Right. Speaking of underground or underwater submerged objects.
Yeah.
So there was that Baltic anomaly that was found a couple years ago that was all over the news. Uh-huh. And if you do a close-up of it, it looks very similar to the Millennium Falcon out of Star Wars. Have you gotten any information on that thing?
Well, the only information I've got is pretty much what everybody else got when the story first surfaced, that, you know, you had these sort of sonar-type shots. That, like you said, it seems to show a sort of circular thing embedded. And then it all kind of went quiet. Yeah, and I don't know as if anything new's come out on it in like the last year or more than that now. It sort of seems to really either died the death or somebody's keeping it, you know, in a lock and key until they're ready to reveal it. Or maybe they're still looking into it. I don't know. But I haven't heard any new updates on it. But I mean, in terms of what have become known as USOs, like undersea objects or underwater submersible objects, as some people call them, that's actually a far bigger part of the UFO phenomenon than many people realize. There are numerous places all around the world where kind of like hot spots where people have seen UFOs coming out of the water. I mentioned Puerto Rico. I've been there on many expeditions, primarily looking for the Chupacabra, but every time I've been there, I've heard stories about people seeing like huge black triangular craft coming out of the ocean late at night. And also sort of going back into the oceans. Also off the coast of Iceland, there were a lot of reports in the 1990s of UFOs coming in and out of the ocean. And also off the east coast of England, interestingly enough, not too far from where Rendlesham Forest is on the coast, which was the site of a famous UFO encounter in December 1980. So, in other words, there are certain areas of ocean that have been hotspots for UFO activity. And there's also been a lot of UFO activity in, or directly above, I should say, the Great Lakes here in the US. There are numerous very good reports of UFO sightings and also chases by military aircraft over large bodies of water. And that's sort of given rise to, you know, questions as to why they're so interested in water. You know, is it a commodity to them in the same way as it is to us? Other people take a darker view. What if they're sort of poisoning the oceans, trying to wipe us out, you know, in sort of be like a biological warfare without us knowing? So there's lots of different aspects. There's actually a good book written by on this entire subject by Ivan T. Sanderson many years ago, the name of which I've now forgotten. But anyway, that book focuses on the idea that what if UFOs come from under the sea, or even if they're extraterrestrial, what if they have permanent bases on Earth under the sea rather than kind of zipping back from point one to point two and so on.
Well, it'd be a good way to hide in plain sight if we really know less about our oceans than we do about our own solar system. So
that's true. Yep.
Interesting. Well, you know, and another thing, too, if we could get back into some of these bases and underground locations, there's a lot of speculation that Dulce, New Mexico has a multi-level underground base. I've been through Dulce several times. Beautiful area. Have you found any information that would pertain to there is very well a location in Dulce?
Well, yeah, there's actually a lot of good data suggesting that something really weird is going on at Dulce. I mean, to go back to the FBI's cattle mutilation file, which is online at the vault, that file actually is packed with 1970s era cattle mute reports, all from Dulce. That's where most of the reports that the FBI studied and received actually occurred. So, you know, this and these reports from sort of 74 to 76 predate the sort of the 1980s era stories of, you know, an underground base at Dulce. That's when those stories really first began to start. But you can, historically, we know that the FBI was receiving cattle mutilation reports from Dulce, as I said, as far back as the mid-70s. Now, if you go back even further to the mid-60s, the Department of Energy had a program called Project Gas Buggy. Project Gas Buggy, the idea was to sort of explode small atomic bombs underground to provoke the release of natural gas. And, you know, in other words, you know, detonate, create a huge explosion underground, and we could get the gas out. One of these detonations actually occurred only like 8 miles from Dulce in an area of forest. And today, that particular area is still out of grounds. The Department of Energy forbids any underground digging in that area because, you know, a small nuke was detonated to provoke the, as I said, the release of natural gas. Now, some researchers suggest, well, what if that was a cover story and the real reason why the official world doesn't want anybody digging there is the fear of stumbling on, you know, this network of underground tunnels and like a rabbit warren of tunnels that these aliens have sort of taken over and infested. So in other words, you can take even the 1980s era underground and 90s era underground base stories at Dulce out of the equation, and you've still got all those cattle mutes official documents on the area. You've got the verifiable fact that somebody was blasting underground in the area in the 60s, and there are signs up now saying you will not dig in this area. So that alone is intriguing. But, you know, these other stories are even more intriguing, the idea that there could be sort of vast tunnels and networks under Dulce in this huge mesa called the Archuleta Mesa. The scenario that has been sort of promoted mainly is the idea that these extraterrestrials, or whatever they are, are the ones that call the shots. In other words, the interior of Mount, the Archuleta Mesa, the interior is out of bounds for all of us. You know, it's they own it essentially, and not us. And there's a lot of talk of bizarre genetic experimentation and people held prisoner and firefights between aliens and humans. And, you know, we really don't know where the truth ends and the room begins and where the disinformation gets inserted. But there's no doubt that we can prove that there's been a lot of really weird stuff going on at Dulce.
Yeah, some of the people report that there's possibly dream connections where they're trying to figure out how to attack people or get into people's heads via dreams and other things. So very interesting indeed. Now, HARP is supposedly being shut down, and I don't know if that's true or not. Have you gotten any information?
Well, the only information, again, is, you know, what's in the public domain and this official story that HARP, you know, is being closed down. You know, the official story of HARP is that it's essentially to assist and expand sort of communication systems via the ionosphere, where then you have, you know, the conspiracy side, people who research HARP who said it can, you know, it can have an effect on weather and so on, and, you know, essentially allow weather to be used as a weapon of war, so to speak. I've got to be honest, I haven't done a great deal of research into HARP, but I mean, you know, I think it'll be interesting to see what comes out, what is coming out, you know, when people who subscribe to the idea that yes, there's something sinister about it, so why is it being closed down? You know, I think there's going to be a lot of questions are going to be asked, and, you know, people are going to be looking for, well, is there going to be another type of HARP set up somewhere else? You know what I mean? Or is it the end of it? And if it is, why is it the end of it? Who's made the decision? So I think there's a lot more on this story to come out from various angles.
Well, I also think you brought up a good point earlier when you were talking about Area 51 and how a lot of people think that that's the beginning and end of, you know, conspiracy locations or hotspots that nobody's supposed to know about. You know, what about Area 50, Area 49, Area 52? Have you the documents that you've had access to, have you found other sites that have said, okay, this is Area 47 in Dugway?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's called Area 51 because the Nevada Test and Training Range, which is what Area 51 is a part of, you know, there are other areas. I mean, there aren't, as far as I know, there aren't like a literally 1 to 100 or anything like that, but there are different areas with different numbers attached to them. And some of them are involved in, like, weapons development, other ones in radical new aircraft designs and so on. But they're all part of this huge test range. And so, you know, we can find, you know, America's sort of a huge place, a lot of desert expanse. So you've got places like in Utah, you've got the Dugway Proving Ground, which does a lot of highly advanced research into things like viruses and biowarfare and that kind of thing. And, you know, sort of preventing a biological attack, that sort of thing. In terms of the stories about alien bodies being stored, yes, a lot of those come out of Area 51, but we also get a lot of stories along those lines out of Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, where since the late 40s there have been rumors about sort of cryogenically stored or preserved bodies sort of in, you know, bunkers perhaps 20 or 30 feet below the base, armed guards on the door, you know, sort of thick vault-like doorways, and these bodies are reportedly just preserved and stored there, more like a museum than, you know, an active research lab, so to speak. So, in other words, where we go digging, we find a lot of places like this all around the world. And arguably that would make sense because if a UFO crashed in Russia or crashed in China, well, you know, they're not going to hand it over to America or Britain or the French. They're going to keep it or whatever they find. And doing so means you have to create a unique environment to preserve and store them in. So it actually makes more sense than less sense that you would have multiple installations. And I think also one of the reasons it makes sense is because if you sort of keep all your eggs in one basket, so to speak, and something happened and that base got destroyed, all the evidence and all the work is gone. By kind of siphoning it out to one installation in this part of the country and then another part of the country, it's, you know, it allows for confusion in terms of people don't know where to look or which stories are true. And I think possibly some of the stories about alien bodies stored at this base or this that base may actually be disinformation. There might not be anything there because it keeps people busy chasing those stories down when then the real base or the real story gets overlooked, if you see what I mean.
Absolutely. Yeah, so, you know, and let's maybe jump into some of the other anomalies around the world, like the pyramids and ancient astronauts. There's statues of lizard men from 7,000 years ago that, you know, are supposedly taller than man at that time. Have you got any documents or information that maybe people that don't have that you could share with us today, Nick, on maybe reptilian presence or these giant lizard men that come from the stars, like Zachariah Sitchin said?
Well, yeah, I mean, I've done a lot of research on the whole lizard man type phenomena because it's sort of like a crossover between, or at least for some researchers, there's like this crossover between the UFO subject and the field of cryptozoology when it comes to creatures like lizard man type entities. You know, some people take the view that they're just linked with the UFO phenomenon, but then we get other reports of these creatures where they're seen roaming around swampy areas like the Florida Everglades, and they seem more like a wild animal. So we could be dealing with two parts of the same phenomenon, or actually separate parts. But I do have a lot of reports of reptilians on file, where, particularly in relation to abductees, where the witnesses and the abductees have talked about how the reptilian creatures seem to be overseeing the procedures. Now, yeah, there are some reports where the reptilians seem to be more like guards or soldiers in some respects. But many of the reports I have is that they seem to be just standing there silently on the fringes, overseeing what's going on, and, you know, just making sure that everything's running smoothly. And I guess you could view that as, yes, they're sort of guardians and keeping control, or they are the ones, you know, calling the shots. But many people are sort of very fearful of the reptilians, even if they're not sure why. You know, maybe it's just the appearance of like a 7 to 8 foot tall, you know, bipedal reptile. Maybe that in itself is enough to, you know, frighten people. But on the other hand, some people have said they just got this sort of sense of evil emanating from them, like a sense of hostility, but for no specific reason other than the fact that that's how they felt. So in that sense, the reptilians are kind of unique in the sense that most people don't report anything positive from them. It's always, you know, there's this sort of sinister, unsettling overtone to the cases. I mean, although these stories are very controversial, I've got a few stories which come from highly credible people but talk about the reptilians literally sort of shape-shifting from human to reptilian. Now, you know, I don't buy into these stories at all that, you know, the British royal family are flesh-eating reptiles, but I have to say, you know, I have to admit I've got some really interesting and fascinating stories from people whose word you would take, you would accept 100% on any other aspect or any other issue, who've said that they have seen, you know, people sort of shape-shift into reptilians and vice versa. And these have been, in a couple of cases, these have been people who felt that they were able to actually see these creatures in their real form. In other words, they took the view that these creatures don't literally shape-shift, but they can affect our minds, almost like hypnotize us, to where we think we're seeing a human. And I think that actually makes more sense. You know, it makes more sense than somebody that can literally alter their DNA, you know, and change from one creature to another. It makes more sense that you could kind of almost, you know, sort of like a rabbit caught in the stare of a snake, you know, it becomes hypnotized. I think it's more likely that these creatures, if the stories are true, and I think they are, that they're not literally shape-shifting. They're actually affecting our minds to where we perceive them as human. We're seeing like an image, but not the real image. And some people seem to be able to perceive beyond that sort of hypnotic veil, if you like. And when you hear stories like this, you know, and supposedly they're infiltrating us, the reptilians, and they pass amongst us and can pass for human. You know, it sounds like, you know, the wildest sci-fi until you realize the credibility of the people who are talking about it. So that's, without doubt, from my perspective, the sort of the most amazing but also controversial and disturbing part of the reptilian phenomenon.
There's a lot of, obviously, videos on the internet that you can watch these people on different mainstream media outlets, and it looks like they're literally, you know, they're shape-shifting almost. You can, you know, whether it's digitalization, I'm sure many times they're hoaxes and camera, you know, glare, whatever you want to call it. But do you think that some of those are genuine?
Well, yeah, I mean, this is the problem. I mean, the more our technology advances, you know, the more chance we have of being hoaxed, and that's why. Equally, go on YouTube and find dozens of pictures of people who claim to have filmed Bigfoot running through the woods. You know,
right.
You see, you know, literally like a 5-second piece of footage that somebody's uploaded, and all you see is a bit of jerky camera, somebody going, dude, look, you know, and then this shadowy black thing runs across. And it could be just a bunch of guys out, you know, drinking beer, and one of them's rented a gorilla suit from the local
store.
And
it most likely is.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's the problem. But when it comes to the UFO subject and you're dealing with, like, UFOs in the sky, you know, I mean, there are a lot of good programs and technologies today where you can really make it look like it's a UFO in the sky or somebody shape-shifting. And I think we need to be more cautious than ever, not less cautious, actually more cautious about how we accept something that looks really great. You know, as just because it looks great, well, maybe it is. But on the other hand, you know, as our technology advances, we need to be more cautious, not just embrace it as necessarily real because it looks real. You know, we want to try and stay away from that. Wow, you know, I want to believe. You know, we don't need to get caught up in that sort of X-Files stance of I want to believe. You know, it should be I believe because the evidence is pretty strong upon evaluation, you know.
Well, and do you feel that could be why there is so much, call it clandestine, like sweet poison, and got the skies being bombarded with chemical trails for geoengineering? Supposedly it's to protect us so that the ice caps don't melt and the, you know, coastal cities become flooded and destroyed and millions of people die. Or is it for some more sinister reasons, Nick? I mean, are they trying to manipulate this atmosphere and slowly kill the population and make it, you know, more habitable for them, if there really is them?
Well, you know, I mean, the problem is a lot of these phenomena, you can look at it from both perspectives. And what makes it more confusing is that there's data which, you know, you can go looking for data and you can find data which supports both scenarios, kind of like with disclosure. You know, there's as much data suggesting we might get disclosure as there are data suggesting it's all getting locked down. And I think what this tells me is that, and white, that it's good guys versus bad guys. I think even within government, there are people with differing agendas. You know, again, a lot of people say, well, the government are the bad guys. You know, I don't think they are. What I think is that there are people in government that want to disclose what's known about UFOs, and there are many people who are adamant that, no, the people cannot know. And I think sometimes, you know, these agencies or offices, whatever you want to call them, it's almost like they're at war with each other over what is going to be done with this data. And I think that could also apply to sort of growing new technologies. There could be people who want to use it for a good purpose. There could be other people who want to use it from a very negative perspective. But we assume that, you know, it's just one agency or one body and they're calling the shots and it's just going down one pathway. So, you know, I think there could be like a silent war going on within the intelligence communities and et cetera. as to what should be done with these technologies. And some, you know, Department A is working on this, Department B is working on that, Department C is trying to stop both of them, and it kind of goes along those lines. It's not, I think, as clear cut as we're looking for the answers and someone's trying to stop us, if you see what I mean.
Oh, sure. There just has to be that balance, I believe, and I'm sure many of our listeners do. And
That's the thing. I think it's balance. I mean, you can look at the idea, for example, of the proliferation of drones today. You know, I mean, are drones useful on a battlefield? Well, yeah, they are. But does every street need to have a drone flown over it? No, it doesn't, you know. And I think that's the important thing, is that there needs to be debate on these issues, or one day there might well be a drone on every street corner, you know.
Sure, yeah, as long as technology is used to help mankind to enslave them, it's a good thing, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, you know, you also put together, man, you've just got a plethora of books here. I'm on Amazon.com right now, Nick, looking at your books, and all of them have fantastic reviews. You've got one or two left in stock, so you're selling them very quick. That's fantastic. The Pyramids and the Pentagon, the government's top secret pursuit of mystical relics, ancient astronauts. You know, Hitler, there's a lot of information out there you can find that he was out there looking for the Holy Grail and all these different relics that are talked about in ancient scriptures. How is our government connected with that?
Sure. Well, I've always been fascinated by the whole ancient astronaut scenario, and also the idea that, you know, what if our civilization wasn't the first advanced terrestrial civilization? What if there were people before us? You know, the final scenes of the original Planet of the Apes, when Charlton Heston comes across the ruined Statue of Liberty, that kind of thing. You know, what if civilizations come in cycles? And one of the sort of criteria I always have when I'm writing a book is you want to be able to give the audience something new. And I'd never written a book on the whole ancient astronaut scenario before, excuse me, because, you know, you don't want to just go over old ground that had been sort of trod by Eric von Daniken or Zechariah Sitchin or whoever. But one of the things that I found over the years was that every now and again I get snippets of stories suggesting that government agencies around the world had taken an interest in the ancient astronaut phenomenon and ancient structures like the Sphinx, the pyramids in Egypt, and the similar pyramids in South America and Stonehenge. And so I spent like about 18 months digging into all these stories as deeply as I could, and found that there was actually like a huge untapped body of material showing how deeply government agencies have looked into various ancient mysteries. I'll give you one classic example. I've got like three chapters in the book, Pyramids of the Pentagon, on the CIA search for the remains of Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat in Turkey. Now, people might think, why on earth would the CIA be looking for the remains of what, you know, the Bible says is this huge old, why would the CIA be interested in this? But they actually are. They declassified to me about 60 pages of material through the Freedom of Information Act, which shows that the interest on the part of what is some people accept as being Noah's Ark, but within the Pentagon and the CIA, they officially call it the Ararat Anomaly. That's its official title. But the story goes back to 1949, when a U.S. Air Force spy plane was flying across Turkey towards the border of the former Soviet Union, because they were going to photograph, like they were going to fly over the border of the Soviet Union and photograph a new missile base that the Russians were building there. Excuse me, military base, not missile base. And as they used Mount Ararat as like a guiding line to reach this particular base in the Soviet Union, as the guys got close to Mount Ararat, one of them reported seeing what looked like a huge wing-like structure sticking out from the ice very close to the peak of Mount Ararat. And as they kind of rounded it, they saw like another wing-like structure sticking out another part of the ice, sort of semi-buried in it. And although people think of Turkey, you know, sort of hot deserts and plains and so on, which it is, the mountains, you know, they're so high. Mount Ararat is so high. It's, when you're at the top of it, it's kind of like Mount Everest. You know, it's icy and snowy. The ice does not melt, you know, all year round. That's how it is. And whatever these wing-like structures were, they were estimated to be somewhere in the region of like 600 feet in length, each one. And clearly nobody back then or even now is flying an aircraft with a 1,200-foot wingspan. But the interesting thing is that it clearly wasn't a boat either. It seemed to be some sort of large metallic wrecked thing. So the photographs, and over the years, as the files show, spy satellites were actually vectored into the area to get imagery as well, because the Turkish government wouldn't allow anyone to go up there and actually check it out. But one of the interesting theories mentioned in the declassified files is, what if Noah's Ark was actually not like an old wooden boat, you know, containing 2x2 animals? What if that story was like a distorted legend of a crashed UFO that came down on Mount Ararat, you know, thousands of years ago, and instead of having 2x2 animals on board, what if it had like an entire DNA collection of, right, you know, numerous animals from the Earth? That would make more sense as to why official agencies might want to get their hands on what we might call an ancient Roswell, rather than just, you know, a rotting old boat, which doesn't make any sense if that's all it is. So that seems to be, at least in part, if not the whole reason for focusing on the so-called Ararat anomaly, because somebody somewhere wants to know what it is. And as I said, they've released about 60 pages so far, and I actually managed to get the original Air Force file photographs from 1949, which I reproduced one of the pictures in the book, where you can see this thing sticking out the ice, and it's clearly something's there, but we, even to this day, we don't know what it is because of the, you know, the inability to access that part of the mountain. So that was one thing I found. Another one was also related to the CIA, was the fact that the CIA was interested in the Dead Sea Scrolls when they first surfaced in 1947. And reportedly the CIA got their hands on one particular scroll that dealt with things like future prophecies and sort of Armageddon and that kind of thing. And it seems to be that someone was in government or the intelligence community was interested in these prophecies of what was to come in the future. There are numerous cultures all around the world, all have their own flood legends. For example, Native American Indians, they have a legend of a flood in which numerous animals were saved in like a huge canoe. And the Native American gods told them to construct this huge canoe, which the animals would be saved in. There are stories from Europe, and particularly Scandinavia, of floods and certain families being selected to, you know, build a huge boat and so forth. So, you know, I think the fact that these stories exist worldwide about, you know, I mean, just sort of cataclysmic floods, I think there probably was one or maybe two or who knows how many worldwide floods that decimated entire civilizations. And it wouldn't surprise me if, granted it's theoretical, you know, if there are extraterrestrials visiting back then and they had an awareness of these looming sort of worldwide planetary disasters, they might well, you know, swoop down and have these sort of huge, gigantic armada-like craft, which would allow a number of people and animals from around different parts of the world to, you know, be picked up and, you know, who knows, been stationary Earth orbit for 6 months until the waters calm down, and then they release the people and the animals back out as the waters recede a little bit into different areas and sort of reseed the world again. So I think that is not an impossibility at all. It might explain how and why different cultures around the world all have legends of the gods coming down and telling certain people and families and things like this how to, you know, preserve life when the floods come and so on.
Right. Now, also a phenomenon that was around thousands of years ago and still to this day are these pyramids, that some of them are aligned so perfectly and in harmony with, you know, certain vibrational frequencies that they're supposed to almost be some type of healing power if you use a pyramid in proper ways, combined with the Cheops there now, the specifications. So the Bosnian pyramids that they found, 12,500 years old possibly, or even older, they found pyramids underwater. What information do you have on the structures, possibly information that's, you know, recently declassified that you could share with our listeners?
Well, yeah, again, I got quite a few files, particularly on the Egyptian pyramids. What was interesting is that several agencies released files to me, through the Freedom of Information Act, and they all reflected official interest going back to the 50s in researchers who suspected that the pyramids, both in Egypt and South America, had been constructed by something along the lines of what we would call anti-gravity or levitation. In other words, not using, you know, ropes, pulleys and brute force, manpower or whatever, but literally sort of making the rocks weightless and kind of almost effortlessly pushing them into place. Now, one of the areas that a number of military agencies around the world are researching today is called acoustic levitation. And this, on a small scale, this has actually been achieved where directed sound waves can be concentrated and a small object can be lifted in what's called the resonance zone. It's kind of like, you know, you're opposing sound waves pushing against each other, and you can direct small objects into the air. Now, that is using sound, basically using acoustics. Now, if you look back at all of the major cultures that created gigantic structures that still baffle us today as to how they did it, many of them have stories about the stones being moved by sound. For example, there's a story from Egypt of the stones being sort of magically lifted into the air. From Stonehenge, there are stories about the stones being moved to the sound of chanting and to the sound of musical instruments. There are stories from South America of certain pyramids and stone structures being built by an ancient race of dwarfs that would whistle these stones into place. Then, of course, you have the story of the walls of Jericho being brought down by trumpets, again, which is sound. Now, I should stress, I don't think we should take these stories literally, that little dwarfs whistle the stones into place, any more that, you know, Stonehenge was built by music or that the walls of Jericho were brought down by trumpets. What I think is that these are all distorted legends of massive stones being affected and moved by sound and along the lines of what we're researching today of acoustic levitation. And what I find fascinating and why I included this story in the book was because it was this aspect, the acoustic levitation angle, that so fascinated the military agencies. They opened files on people like Maurice Jessop and Bruce Cathy, two primary researchers who were looking into the idea of levitation being used to move these massive blocks. Now, of course, we're just at the fringe of doing research into this area today. You know, we can move small objects like the size of small stones into and levitate them into the air. Clearly, if somebody was moving multi-ton blocks 10,000 years ago, you know, was this an ancient terrestrial civilization that destroyed itself and, you know, who we relegated to like mythology, kind of like the people of Atlantis, that sort of thing? Or was it extraterrestrials, or was it both? We don't really know, but I think there is enough circumstantial evidence, at least, to suggest that the ancients somehow had the ability to make these massive stones almost weightless. And acoustic levitation would actually be, if we could perfect it, would be a way of doing that. I mean, there's actually a classic, more recent example in Florida, the whole story of Coral Castle. People aren't aware of that, you know, this sort of modern-day mini-Egypt where, you know, people just cannot figure out how this one guy alone moved all these massive blocks. You know, he was never seen having any help, and yet, you know, he created all these fantastic structures. And that creates as much controversy today as the construction of the pyramids. People just cannot figure out how he did it.
You know, and let's get back to some different species or different types of extraterrestrials that you've researched. We had a guest on here a few nights ago, Daryl Sims. He calls himself an alien hunter. He used to work for the company, a.k.a. CIA. And basically, with his experiences, he feels that these gray men, these different reptilians are actually clones, and that they're cloned on some gigantic spaceship that has even traveled into our solar system, but he feels that it might be more deep than that, like, as you say, more like interdimensionals at a higher level. What other species have you found information on besides just the typical grays and reptilians?
Well, one of the areas that sort of really fascinates me, which I wrote all about in a book called Contactees, are the sort of so-called space brothers. These are sort of the more very human-looking aliens that typically sort of first began to surface in the early 1950s. A lot of researchers today don't have much time for that sort of era of the so-called space brothers and the contactees, but for people who aren't aware of the phenomenon, back in the early 50s onwards, there were a lot of reports of people meeting in desert locations, particularly in sort of like California, New Mexico, Arizona, eerily human-looking aliens, usually sort of 6'5" to 7 feet tall, long blonde hair, and they would sort of impart words of wisdom and warn us about atomic weapons and so on. Now, on the surface, a lot of these stories, or you know, they sound kind of extreme and unbelievable, but the more you dig into them, there is a real genuine phenomenon that these sort of Nordics, as they've become known, are a valid part of the UFO phenomenon. I fully do believe that. But again, the problem is today, they're not sort of in vogue. You know, they're not sort of perceived as an area we should be looking in. It's, oh, no, that's just that nonsense from the 50s. And that's one of the things we're up against. You know, it's not just official secrecy. It's like, in many respects, the UFO community often self-censors itself because it doesn't want to deal with these sort of rogue-type cases. But that aspect fascinates me. And another one is one that pops up now and again in relation to UFO reports, and that's the so-called hairy dwarf phenomenon, as it's become known, where people have claimed to have seen sort of 3 to 4 foot tall, hair-covered creatures in relation to UFO activity and in close proximity to UFOs, kind of not Bigfoot, almost like Littlefoot, if you like. And so, you know, we have those reports. And then, of course, we have creatures that, you know, sort of straddle some realm between the Space Brothers and the Greys of today. I mean, if you take the Betty and Barney Hill alien abduction of 1961, probably the most famous of all alien abductions because, you know, it was really the one that kick-started the abduction phenomenon and movement, if you like. But Betty and Barney Hill said that the aliens they saw, even though the case had become linked with the, you know, the Greys and abductions, they said the aliens they saw were like 5 feet tall, actually quite human looking, had large noses, and, you know, they had like cat-like eyes, not solid black eyes, that were grey-like. You know, they were smaller than the average human, slim, but they had human aspects as well of the, you know, kind of like the Space Brothers of the 50s. So, in other words, they weren't classic greys. Now, of course, you also have the kind of almost like a spin-off of the greys, the more sort of thinner, spindly greys that have this sort of insect-like appearance, like the praying mantis type, as they become known. They look really sort of creepy and spindly and, you know, as I said, insect-like. And they're clearly a different, I say, breed or type to the classic greys, but they seem to somehow be connected. And again, this makes me wonder if we're dealing with, like you just sort of alluded to, the idea of clones or different types created for different purposes. That's actually one of the things that's been suggested with the Men in Black. Perhaps the reason they're so strange is because what if they're like a biological robot that essentially just sent out to perform a task? That's to say, they go to the home of the witness and they silence them or threaten them. But, you know, if you imagine if instead of, like, having a virus scanner on your computer that protects it from viruses, you know, you what if you activate a biological robot, one that really doesn't have any sort of self-awareness or just a vague self-awareness that it even exists? All it knows is this is what it has to say and what it does, and then it doesn't really have an existence in the way we understand it. And I think that could well apply to the Men in Black, and it could equally apply to the Greys. You know, they may not really have an understanding of what they are or even think about what they are. You know, maybe they're just created to perform a specific task and they're nothing more than, you know, the equivalent to Kaspersky or whatever, you know, checking for problems on your hard drive. They're checking for this or that, or, you know, abducting people and performing tasks with no real personal understanding of why they're doing it.
Well, speaking of hard drives, there's, you know, the Matrix that came out 15 years ago or so that really opened up a lot of people's eyes to just different possibilities. You know, clearly what we do see, if we were to break it down into the quantum level, would be, you know, these microscopic, you know, protons, neutrons, electrons bouncing around and just oscillating in particular frequencies, really. So these Men in Black, are they like Agent Smith? Do you feel that we are in some type of holographic type matrix setup?
Well, yeah, I wrote a book back in 2011 called The Real Men in Black, which looks at all the different theories for them, like government agents, time travelers, paranormal, so forth. And I actually think there could well be something to the idea that, you know, the world we live in isn't all that it appears to be. I mean, I've had a lot of weird experiences and strange synchronicities, and where you begin to question the nature of what reality is or isn't. And I think a lot of people, when you open your mind to it, you do begin to realize that the world's not just, you know, sort of knock on wood realities we see it, that there is something else to it, and reality might not be what we perceive it to be. And certainly when it comes to the Men in Black, that they are actually like in the movies, in the Matrix movies, in the sense that it's almost like they don't exist before they knock on the front door. You know, people have talked about seeing them in cars sometimes, but it's like the car suddenly vanishes or fades away. The Men in Black, you know, even if it's muddy outside, there's no footprints leading up the driveway to the house. It's like there's suddenly a knock on the door, and that's when they suddenly start to exist. They're let in. They question the person. They don't seem familiar with our customs and mannerisms or even our speech at times. They sometimes act clumsily. And if you stand up against them, you know, you'd imagine that they would sort of throw you against the wall and threaten you. They don't. If you stand up against them, it's like you put a glitch in the program and they don't know what to do. And they very often quickly make uses and leave. It's like literally like you have put a glitch, you know, in a particular program, or it's been hit by a Trojan or whatever, and you're the Trojan, you know. And so I think there could well be something to this idea that whether they're like a biological, physical virus, or we literally are living in some sort of world that isn't actually fully 3D, and that reality can be, you know, whatever some overseeing entity or intelligence wants it to be. You know, maybe I don't sort of go with the whole, you know, the literal scenario that we're all living in pods, you know, and we're all the equivalent of a Duracell battery or whatever. But I do think reality is more than we see it as. And I think possibly reality can be shifted to allow temporary entities, or even like a holographic entity or something along the lines of the Men in Black, to enter our reality temporarily and do whatever they've got to do, and then reality shifts back to normal. You know, it's kind of like you go to bed at night and you dream. Well, what if they could actually create a dream in your living room? You know, that they're not really there, but something's creating the dream of the Men in Black, and it's so real and so 3D. You really do think, you know, they're sitting on your couch grilling you.
Yeah, that's a really good theory that I haven't came across yet. So that makes a lot of sense, especially with the way that you're explaining it. That could describe some of the anomalies. So,
and it might also explain why these things are so elusive. If they're not physically there in the way we understand it. They look like they're physically there. That might explain why, with the men in black particularly, we never catch one. You know, they're always gone before anybody else is on the scene. You know, it's almost, it would be too good to be true if they were just government agents. That's why I think, you know, the government is probably as puzzled as we are as to who the real men in black are.
So maybe we could get into now some of the connections with what people say are demons or lower type entities. You've done a lot of research in that. I know you've got a book out there, Final Events in the Secret Government Group on Demonic UFOs and the Afterlife. So what information can you give us on the afterlife?
Well, yeah, Final Events is probably the most controversial book I've ever written. And I always sort of preface it by saying that it tells a story of a group within government, like a small think tank type group, that concludes the UFO phenomenon is literally demonic. And by demonic, I mean, you know, sort of hell, the devil, the whole thing. You know, they take that view.
Right.
And I wrote the book because it's a fascinating story as to how and why this group came to exist and how and why they came to their conclusions. But what I stress in the book is that, you know, they're a very religious group, which it doesn't bother me, their belief systems. But I stressed when I wrote the book that I wrote the book because it's a fascinating story, but it's not my personal belief. You know, what I did was to write the book from a detached perspective. You know, it's not me promoting the story and saying, look, this is the actual answer. It's me saying this is how and why the group came to that conclusion. So I always sort of stress that to people, that it's, you know, I wrote it because I found it, you know, just massively fascinating as to that a group was being funded officially to look into the idea that the UFO phenomenon was a deceptive, demonic invasion.
What's the name of the group?
Well, the nickname, at least, was the Collins Elite, and that was like an internal nickname, in the same way that the CIA calls itself, you know, the nickname is the company. But I suspect there's probably an official name that I unfortunately never got. And I think the reason why there's an official name and an unofficial name is because if you just reveal to a limited degree the unofficial name, then nobody can officially track it down, if you see what I mean. You know, if you use the Freedom of Information request to obtain documents on the Collins Elite, you wouldn't get anything because technically no group by that name exists. It's the internal nickname that the members used. I think that was done deliberately. But the story itself, how I uncovered it, well, I actually didn't uncover it. What happened was that I was speaking one day with a fellow researcher named Ray Beauchet, who lives in Lincoln, Nebraska. And Ray had done a lot of research in the 80s into the Rendlesham Forest UFO landing in England in 1980. And I was thinking about doing a book on this and called Ray up, and because he'd done research, asked if we could have a chat, and he said sure. And he told me during the course of the meeting that some of the information that he got on the case had come from two Defense Department physicists who were working on this program to contact, what they didn't call them aliens, they called them non-human entities, or NHEs. And this particular Pentagon group, apparently, that Ray's contacts worked for, initially thought they were dealing with extraterrestrials, and then they found that a lot of the people working on the project began to fall sick. There was like a run of bad luck and some deaths on the program as well. And they came to believe that the so-called Greys, or if you like, the holographic image of the Greys, which was the theory they came to conclude, was that they weren't extraterrestrial, that they were literal demonic entities presenting themselves as extraterrestrials as a means to kind of get their grips into us, to influence us, to manipulate us, and to prepare for, you know, the final battle between good and evil and Armageddon and, you know, the whole thing. And apparently the group existed in some capacity, and certainly in its early days in an unofficial capacity from the 50s onwards, and certainly existed into the 90s and to an unclear degree in the 2000s. Now, it wasn't like a, you know, an agency like the CIA where they've got a gigantic headquarters and, you know, 20,000 or 30,000 people working for them. We're talking about a group that at any given time may have had 40 or 50 members and operated on a somewhat flexible basis, but that was heavily funded to look into this phenomenon. And they studied a lot of like old biblical texts, and also a lot of texts of other religions as well, to try and figure out if there was evidence that the so-called modern era of ufology from 1947 onwards could be viewed as a satanic deception. And that's what they concluded. They had some very fascinating conclusions, which is, again, why I wrote the book. One was that they concluded that no one has ever been physically abducted. They took the view that abductions are real, but their approach was that these demonic entities projected like the imagery of an abduction into a person's mind, kind of like the Matrix, where you think it's a real event, but it's all going on in like a dream world. And they concluded that nobody in an abduction scenario had ever been abducted from their bed or car or whatever. It was just the creation of like a highly sophisticated hologram created solely to sow the seeds of the idea that the abductors were aliens and to reinforce this meme, if you like, that the UFO phenomenon was extraterrestrial. And so they had a lot of beliefs like that, the idea that it was all holographic and imagery sowing the seeds. Now, at least part of the conclusion was based on the fact that many of the members were highly religious, had sort of held strong religious beliefs beforehand. So that may well have influenced their conclusions. And they admitted that, you know, that the people I spoke to, which was in a very sort of cloak and dagger fashion, I was only able to speak to sort of five or six of the members. And this and that was only because via the contacts that Ray Beauchesne had, that opened a couple of doors to allow me to speak to them. So, I've only admittedly, as I've always admitted, got sort of a limited insight into but certainly enough to write like a 300-page book on how and why they came to exist and the conclusions they reached. But personally, I don't agree with their conclusions that, you know, we're dealing with literal demons from a literal hell that are masquerading as extraterrestrials. But I do think the fact that they came up with that conclusion, that this history and this group, is a story worth telling, if you see what I mean.
You know, and that's also interesting to bring up because the revelations in the Holy Bible, you know, the Abrahamic texts, There's a lot of doom and gloom that says things are going to happen. And then people will say nowadays, well, that's happening right now because of this. And, you know, there's some real weird things in there. But, you know, I obviously have an open mind. I listen to a lot of different ideas and views. I sometimes wonder, though, if there is somebody controlling the scenes, if Revelations is more of a handbook to use as, okay, this is what we're going to do next to cause some type of scenario, you know, instead of it actually being prophecy. But, you know, once again, these are all just theories and speculation.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. We should be open-minded, you know, on all these issues. Where I agree with the Collins elite is that I do think at times the UFO phenomenon has clearly been deceptive and manipulative and hostile. And those are sort of the key ingredients of the Collins elite's conclusions, that the phenomenon wasn't friendly, that whatever it was doing, its own ends. And certainly their most unsettling conclusion, and again, they admitted this was a belief system, and this sort of ties in with the Matrix as well. They concluded that the entity, that the imagery that we have sort of heaven and hell is actually not correct. They viewed heaven and hell as like multi-dimensions, not literally like just a heaven and hell, but they were multi-dimensions that could be accessed in like an out-of-body form. In other words, it could be explained by science. And they concluded that these entities kind of dwell in one of these multi-dimensions that we have dumbed down, if you like, and called hell in simple terms. They didn't believe, you know, that there was like a fiery pit and a guy with horns, but they did believe there was like a negative entity that, you know, was intent on destroying the human race. Well, not so much destroying the human race. What they concluded was that they actually don't want us gone. The Collins elite concluded that the Earth is like a farm and we're the herd, and that what happens is that, you know, we're here for 70, 80, 90 years or whatever, and that when we die, they cull a form of energy from the human soul. In the same way, like in the Matrix movies, you know, the electrical energy in the human body is designed to power the machines in the movies. They took the view that the human soul powers these demonic entities. So in other words, the reason they don't land and say hello, or the reason they don't destroy us, is because they don't want to do either. They want to maintain the farm. They want as many of us to live as possible, because the more that live, the more that die. And the more that die, eventually die, that's more soul energy for them to essentially devour. You know, they're sort of like parasitic things living on human soul energy. That was the sort of bleak scenario they came to.
You know, and I'm not a religious person at all by any means, Nick. I do consider myself spiritual, but it seems like on some of these levels that group might be onto something. What do you think about that?
Oh, yeah. No, what I should stress is where I agree with them is that I do believe that the UFO phenomenon, as I said, it might be probably isn't extraterrestrial, but it's more interdimensional. But these entities seem to want to promote themselves as extraterrestrial. So I agree with the Collins elite on that. And I also agree that the phenomenon's being manipulative and doesn't necessarily always have our best interests at heart. But that's sort of a big step from saying truly demonic in the accepted religious term. You know, that's a big leap that I'm not able to take without proof, just belief. But their main belief was that the Earth, like a farm, and we are the cattle. And they believe that these entities want to preserve the herd. They want to preserve the human race. They don't want to land and say hello. They don't want to destroy us. They just want to maintain us. Because the Collins elite concluded that the human soul, and they never really, or at least the ones I spoke to didn't reveal as to how they had concluded this or knew this, but they concluded that the human soul contained a form of energy that these entities lived on. Kind of like in the Matrix movies, you know, we're all living in these pod, dreamlike pods, and the human electricity that is generated by the human body, you know, feeds the machines. They took the same view, that the soul energy feeds these demonic entities. And so that's why they have such an interest in us, because we actually are, in essence, their food, which is sort of a bleak scenario and kind of disturbing one if it's true. And admittedly, there are a number of abductees who've spoken about how they felt during the abduction experience, their soul or their essence, however you want to term it, was being sucked out of their body, like a psychic vampire situation. So, you know, I can't say that the Collins elite aren't onto something. My personal view is that they got too bogged down in saying it was literally according to this particular religious tradition, and this other religious tradition got it totally wrong, this one got it totally right, and so that's what the answer is. You see what I mean? They were so rigid.
They were too stuck to their dogmatic.
Yeah, they didn't allow for any room. But in terms of their basic beliefs that there's something weirder going on than we think, than just nuts and bolts aliens, I think they were fully on track. But as I said, the problem is, you know, when you're dealing with just six people or thereabouts who were in the group across the course of 30, 40 years at different times, and we could have been dealing with a group that overall at any given time had 50 or 60 people in it, and when, you know, over 50 years that could be several hundred, I clearly only got part of the story. But I think it's still in its early stages. I mean, the good thing is, since I've written the book, other people have come forward and have done their own research and have found other people attached to the group or have been approached by it. And so I think, you know, other authors are going to come out with more information on this story than I uncovered. And it is a disturbing story. You know, you imagine the idea that the Earth is just a farm, and we're cattle being, you know, farmed for our souls. Kind of like, you know, as I said, with the machines in the Matrix is farming us for energy.
Well,
it's a pretty bleak scenario.
Do you think that our DNA was manipulated at one point in time for these handlers or archons or whatever you want to call them to harness our soul energy?
Well, yeah, that's actually one of the theories that, you know, we're not talking about, oh, they just extract our souls via some weird religious magic or something like that. No, they're saying that all of this, although they took a religious view, they took the view that heaven and hell could be explained like via quantum physics talks about multi-dimensions. They actually felt it was one of these hell was like a multi-dimension explainable via quantum physics, but it was still home to negative entities that were exploiting us. So in that sense, you know, I think I think you're right. You know, when we look into this whole scenario of what they might be and what they're doing, no, we can't prove it, but, you know, we should, I think, at least address it as to, in terms of the implications and, you know, what it could all mean for us. And, but again, you know, when it comes to things like this soul energy, we are right that they thought that the human lineage, if that's the right term, had been altered to where we would eventually we all had souls and we could all be milked of that soul, if you like. You know, it wasn't something that was difficult for them to get hold of. Although in saying that, there were some stories where supposedly they'd interviewed abductees or people who'd had near-death experiences and had encountered these negative NHEs, as they call them, non-human entities, that were sort of, and then there were these, almost like the Space Brothers from the 50s, battling for the soul of the person who was undergoing the near-death experience. And one of these creatures here was like a grey and one was like a Space Brother, and they were battling for the person's soul. So it was almost like there was like a heaven and a hell as they saw it, and, you know, the battle was for people's souls, not in sort of the ancient biblical sense, but in a science sense of harvesting the human energy. Probably going to keep a few people awake at night, but yeah. But as I said, I want to stress to people that, you know, they did tell me they didn't have any proof of this. They concluded it based on sort of covert clandestine interviews with abductees, and they said, you know, we're doing this on behalf of the government. We'd rather you didn't speak about it, and apparently the people didn't. But they, you know, they admitted that it was a conclusion based on belief rather than hard evidence. So, you know, it's still open to debate. They admitted they didn't have any way to actually prove this was what the end game was, so to speak.
Right. Do you feel that demons are real? Do you think that that's a real phenomenon, or is it more of just an entity that is what it is? It's not necessarily good or evil. It's just a lower dimensional frequency being that vibrates at that particular energy level.
Well, yeah, I think there are things that have become known as demons today or in the past, and I think they're the same phenomena that other, you know, in other religions they call, you know, the jinn of Islam is actually not that much different if you look at the stories to the demon of Christianity. You know, and then there are other religions and other cultures that have their own, like the, you know, the underworlds and so forth. And what I personally think is that there are, like, other realms of existence. You know, quantum physics today is allowing for the existence of multi-dimensions. And I think some of these entities could be more energy-based and exist in a reality that is so different to ours, but that can actually dimensions into ours. And I think this could well be what is responsible for the legends and stories of demons and jinn, in the sense that they are negative entities that really don't like us at all, but that coexist with us and manipulate us and use us. But that doesn't necessarily mean they're literal jinn or they're literal demons from a literal hell. I think they're more likely to be highly negative entities from a type of existence that science one day will explain, but right now isn't able to fully explain.
Nick, if you would, give our listeners your website and where they could get access to your information, please.
Sure. Well, people can reach me at nickredfern40.blogspot.com. That's Nick Redfern, F-O-R-T-E-A-N, nickredfern14.blogspot.com. Or if you type me into Facebook, if you type Nick Redfern, there's, I think there's like 10 or 11 Nick Redferns, but you scroll down, you'll find me wearing a Sex Pistols T-shirt or something on the photograph, and that'll be me.
Excellent. Well, we'd love to have you back on again. I know you're writing, you're finishing up a book right now. And
yeah, I've actually got a new one out. It comes out on the 23rd of this month. It's called Kind, and it's all about mysterious deaths in ufology of researchers and witnesses and pilots and, you know, sort of like the dark side of ufology.
We'll be looking forward to that.
A very special thank you to our guest tonight. For all of you that had the opportunity to be here with us, if you enjoyed the show, follow us on YouTube, youtube.com/clandestinetimelord, for the most recent interviews, videos, and podcasts. Or you can check us out on the World Wide Web, www.leakproject.com. Would you like to be a guest on our show? Do you have information that the world needs to see and hear? Send us an email. guestbookings@leakproject.com. Thank you, everybody. This is Rex Bear with Leak Project. Stay safe and be the change you want to see. Good night.